Welcome to another edition of Reflections, the Lightyear podcast. My name is Auke, and joining me from Lightyear is Tom, Head of Business Development. Today, we have a special guest, Miriam Dalli. She's a member of the European Parliament, working on the energy transition, but perhaps you can best introduce yourself, Miriam.
Hello to both of you, and thank you for this opportunity. Well, I am a member of the European Parliament. I come from the island of Malta. I am also the Vice President for the Social Democrats, and I'm responsible of the European Green Deal. As you know, we're working a lot on the European Green Deal at the moment, and I'm sure that we'll have a lot of work in the coming months on this. I've been working on car legislation for the past years as well. I was the Parliament rapporteur on the CO2 legislation for passenger cars and light commercial vehicles. And our aim was to reduce CO2 emissions from these cars post-2020. And I'm also working as shadow rapporteur on the real driving emission legislation that we have just voted in the European Environment Committee a few days ago. So that's, you know, a brief introduction.
And as I told you, we're always doing the Fast 15, which is a series of 15 fast questions. And if you're ready, let's kick it off.
Yes, sure.
So what did you have for breakfast this morning?
Shake.
Who's your biggest inspiration?
My parents.
What show or series are you currently watching?
Last Man Standing and SWAT.
Meat, vegetarian or vegan?
Vegetarian.
The happiest moment in your life?
When my kids were born.
Brussels or Strasbourg?
Brussels.
Ooh.
Your most played song?
In Your Eyes.
Talking or listening?
Listening.
What is your current car?
A Mercedes.
When traveling to Brussels, what do you always take with you?
My AirPods and my iPad.
Favorite dish from Malta?
Timpana. It is, but I have to explain this. So it is like pasta with red sauce. We bake it and we put it inside pastry. But it's amazing. The combination together is amazing.
That sounds delicious. What is on top of your bucket list?
Traveling to some remote island.
Your greatest fear?
Ending up alone.
Beach or mountains?
Beach.
Ambitious or realistic?
Ambitious and realistic.
Ah, and great nice. Answer.
That's how we know you actually, Miriam, for both being ambitious and realistic at the same time.
It's important.
Quick introduction of myself for the podcast listeners. I'm not Noortje, but I'm Tom Selte. I work at Lightyear. I know Miriam now for a few months, and she's been very helpful for Lightyear. And I was very, very amazed by the work you did, actually, on the legislation. I think we want to start first on that topic. And actually, you already said it in your introduction. You did an amazing job. Can you explain a bit about what you actually did a few years ago on this legislation part for CO2 emissions?
Sure. So we had this regulation. It was a review of previous legislations because, as you know, we had already some limits on how much cars could emit CO2. There was a whole scandal around that when it was found out that cars were emitting much more on the road than they were doing in the laboratory. But there were standards that needed to be upheld. Then the European Commission wanted to move from what is known as the NEDC to the WLTP, which is how they are going to start also measuring these standards in cars. But this legislation was for CO2 being emitted from passenger cars and light commercial vehicles after 2020, because the legislation that was previously there covered the period until 2020. So we needed to come up with targets that were ambitious but also realistic, because you know as much as I do that when it comes to any industry, when you have also workers involved in the different industries and you have the competitiveness of a whole continent, you need to make sure that you balance out all the different aspects. So the final result, it wasn't easy to arrive at that final result, was that in December of 2018, we managed to reach a deal with the member states where we said that cars on our roads will emit 37.5% less CO2 from the period 2030 onwards, and it is 31% for vans and 15% less CO2 for the period from 2025 to 2029.
As a solar car manufacturer, the fact that we want to reduce CO2 emission is very obvious. And the fact that other parties are having cars on the road that can actually pull this off is very clear. So why is this industry so resistant to actually adopt this new perspective? What is holding them back, so to say, in your view?
From all the meetings I held, it came really clearly out that you have an industry that for a very long time invested in fossil fuel technology. So you have an industry that for a very long time invested in petrol and diesel technology. And they wanted to keep on investing in that technology. At least that is what, from my perspective, I was understanding. Apart from the fact that many people are resistant to change, and sometimes industries, they are, you know, producing certain products and they get profit from those products, why change a model that is working for them? But the reality is that there needs to be much more awareness when it comes to the environmental aspect, particularly the climate aspect. And it's also about innovation. And here, it is not only about the industry itself, but also about policymakers, because I think for far too long, even the European Union hasn't invested a lot in research, in innovation, in technological development. And when you do not invest a lot in innovative ideas, then you continue, you know, going around with the same technology that you were using before. Now, this legislation is not even saying at this point in time, change all your models and make sure that all the models are EVs or zero emission vehicles. What it says from your whole fleet of vehicles, make sure that the whole fleet together, you can reduce CO2 emissions. So it would mean that a car manufacturer will have a mix of more efficient internal combustion engine cars, low emission vehicles like plug-in hybrids, and zero emission vehicles. And I never speak about electric vehicles. I speak about zero emission vehicles because I believe that there will be so much development in so many different technologies. So Lightyear is one case in point where you can come up with new technologies that can help us have on our roads vehicles that are zero emission.
So that's, I think, a great bridge, Miriam, to also your role within the Committee of Industry, Research and Energy. You're not only doing legislation on automotive, but you're also very much aware of the technology in Europe and how we can improve it. And actually, how should Europe actually help to accelerate these technologies where you are talking about?
It's all about investing money in the right direction. So we can speak a lot about being innovative and about making sure that we have the technological advancements that are required. But if we do not invest money there, then we will never arrive at a point where we have the technology that can actually deliver the results that we want with the Green Deal. And I'm all the time linking this with the European Green Deal because I think and honestly believe that this is the way forward. We need to be innovative. We need to give space to technology that can deliver. But we need to make sure that at the same time, this technology, but these industries that can help us deliver the European Green Deal are competitive, that we protect workers and make sure that there is social protection along the way, and at the same time ensure that there is climate and environmental benefits.
But the argument, Miriam, of these companies is like, yeah, you're going to steal our jobs, the automotive industry, you need to support them, and we need to have job security. At the same time, we need to invest in new companies like Lightyear, which has, of course, we have 110 20 people working at us, but it's not like the same as the German automotive industry has.
Not yet.
You're 100% right. So let me take the first part of your statement, because when I was negotiating the CO2 legislation, I remember the industry itself telling me that jobs will be threatened. And obviously, they were relaying this message also to their workforce, who was concerned. So I remember having loads of meetings as well with trade union representatives, because there was this concern of people losing jobs. But it was really positive to hear from workers' representatives from certain companies and also trade union representatives that they were understanding that other continents were taking the lead. And they were understanding as well that if their own company was, by the way, investing in zero emission vehicles outside of the EU, but retaining ICE vehicles inside of the EU. So the workers were realizing what was happening as well. And they were realizing that if they were not going to push also the company to go in a different direction, they were going to be stuck with ICE vehicles in the EU and other continents taking advantage over the European Union as a whole.
But talking about change, let's take the elephant in the room. There's of course one American company that is disrupting, you could say, the industry, which first became more valuable than Volkswagen, now actually became more valuable than Toyota, and actually, but I believe, given the recent run, of course we're talking about Tesla, they are as valuable as five or six major car corporations added together. And of course, sort of the multiples that they're talking about in terms of their real sales and the actual valuation, it's going through the roof. Of course, there's the news of the Berlin factory. Do you think that these types of developments are giving you sort of ammunition to raise the ambition for Europe to perform on these CO2 targets?
No, definitely. So one of my strongest arguments was always, I do not want to see other continents taking the competitive edge over the EU. Because the EU many times boasts about a very strong automotive industry, but we need to adapt to time, and you need to adapt to new innovative technologies. It's useless doing the same product of 10, 20, 30 years ago when you see other continents, you know, taking the lead. Which brings me to the second part of your statement. We have, like Lightyear, new innovative companies that, okay, at this point in time, you said you have like 20 employees, but you know, it's a startup.
120. 100 more, but it's still small.
120, sorry, I forgot. I didn't hear the first bit. But you know, it's still small, but every company starts from being a small company. It has to find investors, it has to find the money to actually roll out models more commercially. But it depends also where the European wants to go.
Perhaps also coming back to my earlier point, as you were mentioning, some other continents are sort of at this point leading the charge, and I haven't even mentioned the Chinese or Asian manufacturers that are gaining momentum. What should we do as Europe to retain? Of course, we have traditionally been at the forefront of any aspect of car manufacturing, you could say. So what's going to save our industry, and what should we do in order to retain sort of a competitive edge in this marketplace?
Embrace change, because many times I feel like we are very much resistant to change.
Right.
And understanding also the market.
And it's actually, thanks by the way for mentioning solar vehicles, because as a matter of fact, of course, we're particularly interested in those. I mean, when you heard about us and heard about Lightyear, I mean, of course, you're even willing to help out with a podcast. What is your perspective on this?
What was your first idea when you heard about Lightyear?
So when I heard about the solar vehicles, for me, it was the idea that I was always pushing for, but seeing it coming in reality. Because I remember when I was negotiating the CO2 legislation and people were telling me, but this is only about electric cars and you are choosing one technology over the other. I was saying, no way, I'm speaking about zero emission vehicles. I do not care what kind of technology is used to deliver zero emission vehicles. If it is through electricity, if it is through solars, if it is through any other kind of technology, but as long as I have zero emission vehicles, what I'm interested in, a vehicle that when it is out on the road, it is not emitting toxic pollutants. So when I saw your vehicle, a solar vehicle, I saw the video and I saw how it was like being driven and everything, I was like, you know, this is the answer to what I was thinking about and speaking about when I was negotiating this legislation. Because I'm a firm believer that when you negotiate something for the 10 years to come, you can't only think with what we know today. Technology is advancing so rapidly, and I hear about so many ideas, so many pilot projects. There is enormous potential, and in the European Union we have enormous potential. I wouldn't want us to lose that talent that doesn't find an opportunity within our continent and they go and find an opportunity elsewhere.
And how could a company like Lightyear help at the European level to accelerate the change? Because effectively we're not just in the business of building cars. We believe in the vision of actually accelerating the transition to, well, beyond sustainable mobility. So how could a company like ours, should we be more present in Brussels, or in what way can we help people to open their eyes? Because effectively that's what we believe that is necessary still.
Make your voice heard, bring your case to the fore, being present there, get your vehicle there so people can try it out.
We will bring our vehicle. Yeah, that's a good one.
And understand, because many times, you know, people are resistant to something that they haven't even tried. And the moment that they try something, they realize that, yes, actually, you know, this can work. And yes, there is the technology. Someone is thinking about it. Someone is working on it. So it's not some fantasy somewhere in some policymaker's mind, but it is actually happening on the ground. And I think that would be the strongest message to pass, to be honest.
Before you have to go, we have a number of questions from our crowd, and I wanted to address these. And I also wanted to discuss sort of your plans for the future, because that's going to be exciting. So we have two questions that we selected. So Matthijs van Schijndel asked, I was in Hungary and saw the price of Euro 95 petrol is 1 euro per liter. How is this helping?
It's not. You know, it's not. I mean, I had this discussion until yesterday. Unfortunately, the European Union as a whole and the different member states have been subsidizing certain fuels.
Right.
And has been subsidizing, for example, fossil fuels. And this brings me to another issue which is linked to what you are working on. Because many times people tell you renewables are still very expensive and it doesn't pay me to actually get electricity from renewables. It pays us more to get electricity from fossil fuels. But unfortunately, many of our member states are until today subsidizing fossil fuels.
Right.
And when they should be subsidizing that kind of technology, which is what we actually need if we want to go towards decarbonization. And this brings me also to this issue of pricing of fuel.
Right.
But we have seen also from a number of studies that you can pay less in the longer term when it comes to zero emission vehicles. Our EU as a continent, the Organization for Electricity, is they have this provision that until 2045, they will be decarbonized as an industry. But we've seen also as well that prices of electricity vary in the different member states. And in some member states, the price of an electric vehicle, for example, would be less than an internal combustion engine when it comes to expenses on fuels. And we're speaking about a solar vehicle. I mean, the answer is there. If you are using a solar vehicle, you will definitely pay much less than you would have to pay for a fossil fuel or for a fuel vehicle or an internal combustion engine.
Perhaps this price is also doing more to actually sort of hinder the fossil fuel industry, because of course they are deeply affected by the price itself and the profit margins that are associated with it. I have another question which is related, of course, from Mohammed, and he was asking, when do you think the law will be enforced to stop all the polluting vehicles from the road, or to take them away from the road?
Honestly, if we really want to be carbon neutral by 2050, and we know that in most of our member states, a vehicle has an average lifespan of around 15 years,
right,
then that would mean that by 2035, we would need to make sure that we do not have any new internal combustion engine vehicles. But, you know, I mean, it's easier said than done.
But what happens if such a vehicle then gets exported to, for example, India, and it still drives there for 15 years? Then we as Europe are carbon neutral, or maybe even carbon negative, but other countries actually get our old cars. Is that a problem?
It's not only to third countries. As things stand today, we have cars, internal combustion engine or dirty fueled cars, being moved from Western to Eastern Europe. I believe that these things, but if I had to now to refer to your question, by these cars being exported to third countries, the European Union has to do its part. But this falls within also a global framework, because ultimately we have to make sure that there is a global framework where all the member states have their own targets that they have to reach. That is one solution to it. Another solution is to actually address the exports of these vehicles through certain policies.
Right. Of course, you've also discussed the things that you've been working on and the current policy. What interests us as well is your personal steps. You've achieved the 37.5%, which is a great achievement, not just for the European Union or for yourself, but for the world. What do you expect to be working on going forward? What results are you looking to achieve, given the complexity of the current situation?
Well, definitely. We're speaking about vehicles, but you can't have vehicles rolled out into the market if you do not have the proper infrastructure. So I will be looking out definitely for the infrastructure to accompany these vehicles. I will be looking also at the possibility of actually producing the batteries within the European Union rather than importing batteries from outside the European Union.
So maybe also batteries. You're looking into production of batteries, but also in production of solar, like PV, because we rely a lot on China and on PV. Are you also having plans to PV industry stimulation?
Definitely. I'm interested in making sure that we push forward certain products like vehicles, like battery electric vehicles, like solar vehicles, but making sure then that the material that is required is not imported from elsewhere, but seeing ways and means how to produce those things that we require here within the European Union.
I think we fully agree. I have one final question for you. If you have any advice for Lightyear, what do you think we should do or keep on doing?
Besides bringing the car to Brussels, of course.
You have to bring the car to Malta as well.
To Malta, okay. That's the next step.
We have a lot of sun here, you know, so I think it would be the ideal place. If I had to give one piece of advice, guys, I mean, I think you're doing great. Just make sure that you continue doing what you're doing. And get out there even more. Because ultimately, I would like your car to be one of those cars that consumers can look to as an alternative when they want to buy a new car. I find many times that people want to buy a zero or a low emission vehicle, but there are many, many obstacles along the way, either because the car manufacturer or the car importer doesn't have the models that they want, either because it will take them like 6 to 7 months to actually get the car from the moment they order it until it actually arrives. It arrives to them, either because there aren't...
They also need to charge somewhere the car? So they need charging infrastructure?
Charging infrastructure is another issue, which, I mean, in your case, it would be one hassle less, probably.
Yeah, that's true.
But, you know, there are many obstacles along the way for people who want to go for these kind of cleaner models, and I would like to see Lightyear being there with your offer of a solar vehicle so that consumers would really understand that there are many, many options that they can look into, which would mean also that price-wise, you would need to produce and go into also a market which might not be too expensive, with models which might also be more accessible to people.
We will, Miriam. That's a great advice.
And it's a fantastic conclusion. So Miriam, tremendous thanks for being here with us today and spending time with us. For our listeners, were you inspired by this story, or do you have any questions to Miriam, us, or general questions? You can send a message to our socials or to our email address podcast@lightyear.one. And in the next episode of our podcast, we'll have an interesting guest that has been an essential force between a serious industry disruptor, and we'll tell you all about it very soon. So thanks again. Stay safe.
Yeah, thanks, Miriam. It was a pleasure to have you.
Thank you.
It was great.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks a lot. And we'll definitely come to Brussels.
Yeah, see you there and see you in Malta as well.
And I'm looking forward to meet you.
Fantastic. Great. Completely reciprocal. Thanks a lot.